How you doing, Miss T?
Yes, yes, ma'am. So I brought back mom with me today, too.
Oh, nice. Uh-huh.
You got a merch, everything.
Good morning and welcome to Peace. We're glad to have those of you here in person and those worshiping online. Let's join together in singing to the Lord.
Glory to his name, for God is great and
plans I have for you. I know just what you're going through. And when you can't see what tomorrow holds and yesterday is through, remember I know the plans I have. Remember, I know the plans I have for you. I know the plans I have for you. I know just what you're going through. And when you can't see what tomorrow holds and your yesterday is through, remember, I know the plans I have for you to give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. Remember, I know the plans I have for you.
Thanks be to God for the plans God has for us. Amen. Strength, joy, hope.
Glory, glory,
amen.
Glory, glory.
Amen. Please be seated, everybody. We need those today. Welcome to worship. Welcome. We are in the church season called Pentecost. It's a long season. We need a long season to be aware of the presence of the Spirit in our lives and how the Spirit is helping us grow and serve, teaching us more about God's love, helping us share God's love in the community in our lives. Welcome to you who are worshiping online today. Thanks be to God for your presence here today, and I hope this worship service is a blessing for you wherever you are. We will be sharing Holy Communion later in this worship service, and if you'd like to share in that, you can prepare bread, wine, or grape juice wherever you are and receive at the appropriate time. Today in the first service, we welcomed three new families to membership of Peace Lutheran Church. Thanks be to God. Woo! And my family is back from a wonderful, relaxing, rejuvenating vacation. Good to be back. This is my opportunity to say to you, I hope you and your family, you personally, are able to find some time to receive the rest that God has for you. Rest for your body, mind, your spirit, because that's what God desires for you. Thanks be to God for the time that you allow me to have away for that rest. It is a blessing. Today in worship of families with children, we have the Pew Pal activity bags that are at the back, the blue bags that can be used by kids during worship to connect in with the scriptures today. We also have the cry room at the back. If that's helpful for anybody. We have Miss Rebecca here who is ready to receive any smaller children into a nursery time in the basement, if that's helpful. And we'll have children's worship time today. We're going to have a children's message today, too, before the children go to children's worship time. So it's a good day for kids. As we begin worship today, we acknowledge that Peace Lutheran Church is located on the traditional homelands of the Puyallup people of the Coast Salish Nation. We lift up the vision that God has given us to be a diverse community of faith in the hilltop where all are welcome, a community that is spirit-filled, compassionate, healthy, reconciled, and just. And we know we're not there yet. We're on the journey. But God's Spirit is leading us into that vision all the time. It is good as we begin worship to share God's peace, knowing that God is a God of peace. We need peace in our world, and we're called to be peacemakers. So peace, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Please take some time now to share God's peace with the folks around you.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, thank you for the joy of being together and reuniting people we haven't seen for a while and loved ones that we're always happy to see. We ask your blessing on this time. Help us to listen and hear from you. And we thank you that you have plans for us, and we trust that you will lead us in those. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading today comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but the very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us. Will he not with him also give us everything else? Yes. Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ who died, Christ Jesus who died. Yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Here ends the reading. Amen.
Please stand as you're able as we welcome the reading of the gospel.
Gospel continues this morning of Matthew chapter 13, verses 31 to 33, and verses 44 to 52. Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until it was all leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field which someone found and hid. And then in his joy, he goes and sells all he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down and put the good into baskets and threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The gospel of our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated, everybody. Children who'd like to come to children's worship time, come on up. Come on up right here. Okay. Good to see everybody today. Welcome, welcome. Come on up. Anybody else want to come up? It's okay. You can make your way up as I'm talking. As everybody, look over here. Well, you know what? I'll go down to you. So you can stay seated right there. Have you ever heard stories about people looking for buried treasure?
No.
Never? Never heard about that? How would people find buried treasure? If there was buried treasure, and you know, some people back years ago used to bury treasure in the ground to try to keep it from people getting it, right? In fact, pirates sometimes buried treasure. Pirates. That was fun. Okay. Yeah, thank you. How would you find the treasure that was buried? What's the story? Dig, yeah, but how do you know where to dig? You have to follow something. Map. You said it. You said the map. I'm sorry. A map that looks like this? A map that looks like this? Right? Something like that? A map kind of like this? Right? Where on the map would the treasure be? The X marks the spot where the treasure is. Okay. On this map, it's the X. Okay. Do you know that Jesus told a story, and he said that the kingdom of heaven is like treasure buried in a field. The kingdom of heaven is like buried treasure. That sounds very interesting. You know, when pirates buried treasure, it would be pretty valuable because it could have like gold coins and jewels in it, right? Yeah. Could have mud in there too? Sure. Could have lots of things in there. Jesus is talking about a treasure that is even more valuable than gold, more valuable than any jewels. You want to hear about that treasure? Does that sound interesting to you? Good answer. Thank you. So I'm wondering if one way to find the treasure that Jesus is talking about is by thinking about the Bible like a map. I have a Bible right here. Could the Bible kind of be a map in a way to find the treasure? Can I have a person who's willing to be a volunteer? Okay. Would you open that and see if you can find anything in there that might be like the Bible being a map? Whoa. What'd you find? Oh, here.
Say it again.
Turn this paper sideways and look the X.
Okay, it's a looks like a map of this worship space, and it looks like there's an X right there on the map. Let me show everyone. Do you see this? Does it kind of look like a map of this place, which we call the sanctuary. Do you see an X there? If I'm holding it right, oh, it's the cross. If you turn the paper sideways, the X looks like a cross. Maybe we should look for treasure right here. Come with me. Come over here. What if we looked for treasure by the cross? Do you see anything that might be like a message or something? Oh, whoa. What does that say? Can you read it?
Uh-uh. Anybody want to read this?
Jesus loves you.
Okay, wait. Oh, we'll get a different volunteer this time. You want to read this?
Jesus loves you.
Jesus loves you. That's an amazing treasure. And we found it right here under the cross. Well, you know what? The cross is a special sign that Jesus loves us. That he was even willing to die on the cross to show us how much God loves us. That is the most special treasure of all from God to us, isn't it? Really, if you think about it, that's more valuable, Jesus' love, than anything else. I wanted to share that with you today and to also help you see how amazingly important. It's like treasure, Jesus' love for us, okay? Thank you, guys. I'm going to invite you now, if you want to go to children's worship time, you can follow Miss Lee. They'll be back later in the worship service, or you can go to your seat. Don't trip over anything up here. Thank you. There's also some flowers up here. Yes, those are pretty cool, too. Yep, thank you. God bless the children of the church. Love the energy. So I spent 1 year in Wenatchee in eastern Washington. It was a long time ago now. I was on a pastoral internship, training to be a pastor, serving at a church there. I stayed in a little house on a hobby farm in the foothills of the Cascades. And it was owned by a family who lived in the big house on that farm. They had 3 elementary school kids. And one day, the 3 kids came to my door and knocked on the door. Intern John, come. Come with us. Buried treasure. We have a map. Let's go. I was like, buried treasure, let's go. I was excited. It was awesome. Like no one ever asked me to go on for buried treasure with them. They said, we got a message on our answering machine. Now that tells you how long ago it was, right? From a pirate. And the pirate told us how to find a map and said that the map would lead us to some buried treasure up in their hills. Arrgh. That's what the voice said on the answer machine. I guess that's how pirates communicate, right? I was going to say in modern times, but you used to communicate. So it was funny. What happened next was I found myself walking up into the hills, because we were right on the edge, into the foothills, with the parents of the kids, the 3 kids, a shovel, a bag, and the treasure map, okay? So there we were, hiking, and the kids were in front, and they were following the map, and they were like, here's the X. So we walked around the big, big rock, right? We went up the gully. It looked like that's what we were supposed to do, through the grove of trees. And then it looked like the X was somewhere under a tree. So they found a tree that they thought was the right place, and they started digging, but kept digging. No, disappointment. Let's look at the map again. They looked at the map. Oh, it must be that tree. So we went to another tree, started digging, got like a foot down, hit something hard. Okay, everybody's really excited. Kept digging, uncovered a wooden, handcrafted box, a treasure chest. They opened it up, silver coins, jewels. Whoa, it was amazing. And then the dad looked at me with the twinkle in his eye. He's like, wonder how that treasure chest got up here. And then they were so excited, and he starts saying, I wonder if the pirates came in from the Pacific Ocean and they came up the Columbia River and they decided to get rid of their loot right up here in these hills. And we were just imagining it. Okay, so that was pretty cool. A month ago, I get a call from that same dad, and he said, want to come over for a treasure hunt? I said, we're there. Now, who had the elementary kids? Me. He had an elementary daughter who had grown up to be now a mom with a child of her own who hadn't gone on the treasure hunt yet. So here we all were doing that treasure hunt up in the foothills, and there was a treasure, and my kids got to experience the excitement, the discovery of it all, a treasure, buried treasure. When you get right down to it, Jesus wanted people to know about, to discover, to experience, to feel the excitement of the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, God's rule on this earth, God's reign on this earth, everything about Jesus, his words, his actions, his life, helped to reveal the kingdom of God. And so he would teach about the kingdom of God. And he often taught, as many of you know, telling stories called parables. And the parables often used common images from their everyday life that they could relate to. But these stories that he told weren't just nice illustrations of his points. No, he used humor, he used exaggeration, he used surprise. He was challenging the status quo with these stories. He was unsettling people. He was challenging them to move out of their comfort zones. These were subversive stories. And he wanted people to expand their imaginations of who God is, what God's kingdom is like, experience God in a new way. So stories Jesus told were often in the form of riddles that people had to figure out. I'm going to give you a riddle right now. See if you can figure this out. Ready? Think. Okay? I like apples, but not pears. I like things that are little, but not big. I like berries, but not bananas. I like coffee, but not tea. What do I like? I don't like avocados. I mean, real life I do, but for the riddle, I don't. Anybody got it? You got it, Will? Come on, he's thinking. Somebody at the first service, right, Twilight, was like, shh, here it is. Well, Antonio was at the first service. No, don't ruin it. So I like words with double consonants, right? Berries, little. Yeah? Apples. Okay? Yeah? Got it? Figured it out? Yeah? Coffee, right? Yeah. Okay. We can play the game now. Right? So, I was going to say, Jesus didn't tell riddles with such easy answers. Maybe it wasn't quite as easy, but still, there is an answer to this riddle. Often Jesus told riddles or stories and didn't give an explanation. It wasn't easy to figure out. He told these stories to get people to use their brains that God has given them to think, to try to figure out what he could be saying, to activate them to new imagination, right, about God. He's trying to say something to them. It helps them think differently about themselves, about God, about God's kingdom. In Matthew chapter 13, which is where we are today, Jesus actually tells seven parables. And the last couple Sundays, we've had some parables. We had the parable of the sower and the seed. We had the parable of the wheat and the weeds. Today, we got five parables in close succession after one another. And I'm going to talk about two, kind of flashes of the kingdom of God. All right, so the first one, Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is like this. And I'm going to tell this story a little bit differently. I'm going to expand on it. It's the kingdom of heaven is like this. There was a hired man who was working a field. Now, the field wasn't very valuable, it appeared, because there were a whole lot of rocks in the field. Didn't look like you plant much in there, but he was hired. Wouldn't be a good field to own, it appeared. So he was hired, and he had his ox and his plow, and he's working it. And he'd go a little bit, and then suddenly, clunk, rock, dig it up. Yep, push it aside. Go a little bit more, clunk, dig up the rock, throw it aside, right? It was over and over again. And what was interesting is he started to build a whole fence around the field, which is what ancient fields often had, right? Walls, because that's what you do with your rocks, and then you have a wall to separate your property there. So he kept on doing that, and then suddenly it went, instead of like plow, clunk, dig, plow, clunk, dig, it was plow, clank. He's like, whoa, what's going on? He dug, and he discovered a treasure chest. Okay, so maybe not a pirate treasure chest, but he discovered treasure hidden in the field, and it was very valuable. I mean, imagine like coins or something very valuable. So he immediately covers it up, goes about the rest of his day, and then sells everything he's got. His plow, right? He sells his ox and everything he has, and he goes and he buys the field. And Jesus says, do you get it? Do you understand about the kingdom of God? Then Jesus tells us this story. He says there was a merchant who had a whole lot of ships, and they sailed all the seas and brought back lots of treasure from all over the place. And so the merchant had treasure chests full of gold and rubies, you know, all these valuable jaspers. But the merchant really wanted very valuable pearl, looking among pearls for the best pearl that there would be. Finally found this pearl and then went and sold all the ships, all the treasure in order to buy this one great fine pearl. Jesus asks, do you get it? Do you understand about the kingdom of God? I wonder, what do these two parables mean to you? What do you think? What does it help you understand about the kingdom of God? Could Jesus be saying something about God's kingdom being hidden in some way? Could he be saying something about some things are really valuable? So valuable that you would sell everything you have for them. Could he be wondering that about different ways that we find what is hidden? Sometimes by accident, sometimes after searching for a long time. I mean, think about the kingdom of God. Sometimes the kingdom of God kind of shows up and you're like, whoa, I wasn't even looking for that. That's the kingdom of God right here. Sometimes it's like, yeah, okay, my eyes are open. And I got a glimpse of the kingdom of God right there. How do we find, where do we find God's kingdom? So I was thinking about the treasure map that I showed the kids, right? And, you know, this one helped me think that maybe there are different maps that we all try to follow, we all use in our lives, seeking some kind of treasure that we're after. And maybe we're on the wrong maps sometimes, looking for the wrong kind of treasure. I'll give you an example. So one of the maps that I think I'm trying to follow is how to be successful, how to succeed as with a family, as a dad, right? As a spouse, working hard toward that. Another map that some of you folks might think of as a map for your life would be how to succeed in your work. Do hard work. Do good work. Be successful. Or how to make money. A map that shows you how to make money. How to be successful financially. To find security there for your family. Or a map that is about finding fulfillment in your life. looking for things that will make you feel good about yourself. Now, all these maps, you know, they're good. They're important maps. They lead us to some kind of treasure that we're hoping to find. We study our maps. We read the books. We might go online for some information to try to help us be better parents or work harder, right? We might seek fulfillment in different places. But sometimes it's dawning on us, this is the wrong map. This isn't the most important map, especially as we're here in church and we hear over and over again about God. We begin to think, as I told the kids, maybe the most important map is coming to us through the Bible, through God's Word. And that most important map is about the kingdom of God. It's the one true treasure. It's the promises of God. It's the presence and power of God. It's about Jesus and Jesus' values, Jesus' ways. It's the greatest treasure of all, greater than all the other treasures. Or maybe it helps us put in perspective all the other maps that we try to follow. Jesus with you today, guiding you, strengthening you, giving, revealing to you the values of God, of love, of peace, of justice, the most important values. The map of the Bible helps us to discover God's kingdom in so many different places. But so often in our lives, we're putting so much of our time and our effort and our attention into these other maps that we may lose sight of the most important map of all. Amen. Anybody with me there? Are you with me? Yeah, I'm there. So let me direct you to some treasure in the Bible, in God's Word. And it is coming out. I hope you were hoping that I was going to talk about Romans 8 today. I hope you were hoping that, because I need this word today. And this is treasure. Thank you, Carissa, for reading this. This is treasure from God's Word to us that we all need in different ways today. We need as a community today. It's priceless treasure. Pure grace, pure promise, pure hope from God. And I want to say first, sometimes finding passages in the Bible that speak to us in a particular situation is like looking for buried treasure, right? You ever had trouble? Like, everybody says the Bible's supposed to speak to me. Where? Where in the Bible is something that's going to apply to my life right now? Well, that is challenging because the Bible's a big book. It's confusing sometimes. And so it is good to have a study Bible. It's good to have a subject guide with your Bible. It's good to go online to an online Bible that you trust, a version that you trust, and do word searches there. You can Google things, but just be careful, right? What you're finding, that's a trusted source. And you can talk to a friend. You can talk to somebody at church. Talk to me if you're looking for how God might be speaking to you through Scripture. I have a booklet. I put together some booklets. One booklet is what I call Promises from God to You in Scripture. All it is some Scripture passages, and it's as if God is speaking directly to you, and I use this sheet of promises when a family has a baby. It's been harder in COVID to do this, but if I get to be there soon after the baby's born, I'll share with that child and those parents those promises of God for this child, and we'll pray God's blessing on that child. I have a collection of Scripture passages that I call Words of Hope and Promise from the Bible, and I give it to people who are hospitalized or ill. I share some of those Scripture passages and then pray for them. This is like, these are pearls. These are treasures from the Bible. And Romans 8 is in there. It is one of those great pearls of great worth for us. Please look at it right now. Did I read this at funerals often? They're powerful words that help us have hope even in the midst of death. So listen to Romans 8:28, right? We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. All things work together for good. Amen? All things work together for good. God can work good out of death? Yes. God can work good out of illness? Yes. God can work good out of tragedy? Yes. Notice it does not say that God always brings the death, the illness, the tragedy, right? It says that God can work good out of these things. In the midst of these might be horrible things, God can work good. Amen. We need to hear that today. And then we go on. Even more, if God is for us, who can stand against us? No one can stand against us. Nothing can stand against us. Amen? Because God is all-powerful in Jesus. And Paul says that. Paul says why no one can stand against us. Jesus, who died, was raised, is sitting on the throne, is now interceding for us. Yes, he's got us. Our future, our security is found in Jesus. Amen. Amen. And then the next part. This is verse 35. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? And then 37, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And then comes the best part. The best part. I've read this particular verse. I remember years ago, in the span of 1 month here at Peace, I read Romans 8:38 at the funerals of a 2-year-old child, a 39-year-old man who had had a rough life and was struggling with addictions and died, a 60-year-old woman who struggled with depression and took her own life, and an 80-year-old man who died at a ripe old age. This promise from God encompasses all that we experience in life, all the challenges. I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen? Amen. That's treasure. That is treasure. Paul's speaking to our deepest needs and fears. Think right now of one fear that you have, one thing you're struggling with right now. I mean, often it's connected with we'll be left alone, or we'll be separated from folks that we love. Paul is putting everything in perspective and showing us the big picture. God's got us no matter what. God's love is holding us. Nothing can separate us from God's love. So maybe your thing is finances. Finances won't separate you from God's love. Divorce can't separate us from God's love. Unemployment can't separate us from God's love. Lack of housing can't separate us from God's love. Struggling in our relationships can't separate us from God's love. Nothing can separate us from God's love. God's got us. It's treasure. If there was ever a message we need to hear today in our world of fear, in our lives of uncertainty, it is this in Romans 8. Thanks be to God for this treasure. So just to kind of bring it to a close today, Jesus is telling us, though, that often the kingdom of God is hidden from us. So if it's hidden, so often, we are encouraged to keep our eyes open, to be seeking God's kingdom, to be looking for it, to do that together. That's what we try to do every Sunday together as Peace. We're looking for God's kingdom. We're looking for Jesus' way. We're wanting to hear about God's love and how to share it with one another. We do this together as a community. We help one another keep our eyes open and search. The Bible is a great place to look. When we discover God's promises, God's presence, Jesus with us, that's the greatest treasure of all. Amen. Amen. Amen.
I'm taking a little change here. To give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. the plans I have for you. Remember, I know the plans I have for you. Give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope, 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 he'll give you joy, he'll give you joy, he'll give you joy, he'll give you joy, he'll give you strength, he'll give you strength, he'll give you strength, he'll give you strength. Oh glory, oh yes, I know he'll hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. He'll give you hope for tomorrow, joy for your sorrow, strength in everything you go through. Remember, I know the plans I have for you. Remember, I know the plans I have for you. He won't forget. Remember, I know the plans I have for you. Let him in, let him in, let him in. Remember, I know the plans I have. Open up your heart. Remember, I know the plans I have for you. Draw from him. Draw from him. Your strength is in him. I know the plans I have for you. Let him embrace you. Let him hold you. I know the plans I have.
Amen. Amen. We're going to move into a time now of hearing about the life and the ministry of the church, and then into prayer, sharing the celebrations and the concerns of our community. Kit's going to lead us, and then we'll add some more words here.
Yellow announcement sheet here, and on the back I'm going to mention a couple of things under opportunities to serve. The gospel choir in the summer sings once a month, and today is actually they were going to sing, but if you are interested, you can come on August 24th to rehearse with Twyla and the rest of us, and then you'll sing on August 27th during worship. And then August 16th, Peace at the Park, which is a chance to come bring your picnic and your all you need for your meal, but then we'll eat together and just enjoy a wonderful time of fellowship, and kids can play in the park, and it's just a wonderful time to be together. And another gathering then in the fall, Women's Retreat, and if you're interested in that, you can register at the welcome table, and Carissa can answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Kit. Wanting to remind everybody that our Director of Community Engagement Outreach, President Nelson, continues his sabbatical. Keep praying for him for rest and renewal in this time. And our deacon, Carissa Carroll, is the point person taking on some of his duties in his absence. Thank you, Deacon Carissa, for that. The alarm code for the building has changed. If you are a key holder to the church building, you need to know that. And you'll need to know the new code, and you'll need to talk to Demish sometime in this week to get that. Just a heads up. Big happenings coming up. So Kit mentioned several things. I'm going to mention the big ones that are really soon upon us. Next Sunday, outdoor worship, barbecue, outdoor games happening. It's all at 11 o'clock. There is nothing happening up to 11 o'clock, so there's no breakfast. There's no 8:30 service. So hopefully people will come at 11, be ready to stay, share good food, share fellowship, share fun, and we'll have also the opportunity for you to bring some food. If you want to bring a side dish or a dessert, That would be cool. Okay. Bring a side dish or a dessert. You can sign up on the sign-up sheet on the welcome table. If you already know you're going to bring something, that would help us to prepare. We're going to have grilled out food, though, to go with that. You do not have to provide. Just come, and we will have a great time as a community together. Teresa Jackson, you can contact her if you have a question about the side dish or the dessert. And then that is the kickoff for an awesome week where we've got Summer Bible Adventure Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday evenings from 5:30 to 8. Summer Bible Adventure for children and families. Compassion Camp. Learning about compassion, having compassion for ourselves, for our neighbor, for the world. It's a great time. We start with a meal, always, and have activities, songs, lots of learning events for the kids. If you would like to help serve with that, we need people to set up, tear down, bring dinner, provide dinner, help as a small group leader, probably some other things that you could do too. If you're willing, there's a sign-up place for serving on the little table outside the office there. We'll register kids next Sunday and then after. So that's going on. That's awesome. Please invite friends, neighbors, coworkers to next Sunday's outdoor worship. Tell anybody with kids that you know to come to Compassion Camp. It is free. It is awesome. Please share that message. Today, by the way, talking about the community, there's the Tacoma Mosaic Arts and Culture Festival at Wright Park from noon to 7. I think our family's going to head over there. That's an awesome thing. Okay, now to something more challenging. Peace Community Center was birthed by Peace Lutheran Church. Now, a couple decades ago, has been our very active and wonderful outreach to students and families of the Hilltop neighborhood, especially with academic support. There have been some recent challenges. And, the church has a deep heart for the center and all its work. We've given birth to the center. I want you to hear from board member Carrie Pedrick a word here to let you know what's happening.
Good morning, church.
Good morning,
Carrie. So many of you know I'm a Peace Lutheran Church member, but my journey actually started as a Peace Community Center volunteer in 2005. I'm a little, that's right, exactly. And then I was on staff at the community center for 7 years. So my history is long, both with the center and the church. I'm also the most recently elected, very recently elected board member for Peace Community Center, and I'm proud to serve in that role. But I bring you a message from the center's board. First of all, our board of directors would like to thank our entire community, and especially Peace Lutheran Church, for their continued support and care. For the young people, I'm sorry, I'm going to drop my pen. The young people that Peace Community Center serves in the Hilltop neighborhood. We are proud of our community's unwavering support for the last 20 years in service towards our communal vision. A vibrant community where youth and families are lifelong learners who use their diverse gifts to cultivate love, justice, and peace for generations to come. Unfortunately, due to challenges over the last year, we are saddened to report that Peace Community Center is not financially sustainable on its current path, and immediate actions were needed. For the past several weeks, the board has partnered with external support to carefully understand the center's financial condition, what factors created the situation, and what paths are available for the center's future and sustainability. During this time, many of you may have received a confusing email that was sent with incomplete information and which was sent without authorization amidst important and challenging conversations. As clarity was gained and continues to be gained, the leadership and the board acknowledged that we would be unable to continue operating without significant financial changes made as quickly as possible. At the end of the planned summer programming, a number of difficult decisions and staff layoffs were deemed necessary. In the coming weeks, the Peace Community Center Board of Directors and a newly appointed interim executive director will partner with you, our community, to discern the future of our programming. We hope to quickly determine what academic programming we'll be able to provide in the coming year, as well as engage with partners and community to discern the unique ways that we can continue serving children and families in the Hilltop future, into the future, sorry. In the meantime, rest assured, the following support will still be sustained by volunteers and through our continued partnership with Peace Lutheran Church. I know you all have the same heart that I do for the services of Peace Community Center to this neighborhood. Thank you. What service? Community meals, community resource navigation, the clothing closet and hygiene supplies, care and support for the young people of this neighborhood. We are so thankful for the staff, for the partners, for the volunteers, many of you who continue to serve and have given so much over the last 30 years. Whew. We ask for our community's continued support, service to students, and prayers as we engage the challenging but necessary work of building a more sustainable future for Peace Community Center. Please reach out to the Board of Directors and our President, Dean Sawhill, with questions and concerns. And we ask for your patience, and we ask for your prayers, and we ask for your engagement as we work through to have additional answers in the days and weeks to come. Peace Community Center Board of Directors.
Thank you, Carrie. I want to say a word of prayer now, and also acknowledge the grief that's present in so many of us and as a church with what's happening right now. Also, with that grief comes hope that comes from God. Right? We remember. I mean, this is Romans 8, the message today that we get from God. God's word in Scripture, the greatest treasure of all, right? In all things, God works together for good for those who love the Lord, who are called according to his purpose. That's what we trust. And so let's have a word of prayer. God, thank you. Thank you for the work of Peace Community Center. Thank you for the blessing of this church and our heart for service in the Hilltop neighborhood expressed through the Community Center. God, we know this is a very challenging time. We pray that you help this now in the grief to be an opportunity for us to discern and pray, be guided by your Spirit into a hopeful future for the students and families in our neighborhood through Peace Community Center. We don't know what the future holds. We trust that you hold the future and that you're guiding us forward, that you are a God of new life. And so, God, we pray that in whatever ways we can be present in this process moving forward, that you will activate this church to be your hands and feet, your instruments of love and care, support for the community center in whatever it looks like into the future. We trust you, God. We're grateful for your love for us. We know that you hold us and you keep us and you hold and keep all the families and the students of the Hilltop and of all the schools in Tacoma. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Carrie. And thank you to the Board of Directors, and thank you to all who support and have served and continue to serve through Peace Community Center. Amen. Okay, a couple more things to say. Right after worship, we will have fellowship and refreshments in the big room. If you feel moved to give an offering today, there's an offering box at the welcome table. We also have a way to give online, of course, send it in the mail to the church office. Thanks be to God for your generosity. Wanting to take a moment to welcome a very special person all the way from Kenya, Reverend Jane Kagochi. Yes. And we want to always be reminding us of Solid Faith Church in Kenya, where Pastor Kagochi is the pastor, and we are partners in ministry. A few Sundays ago, Tony was there, right, bringing greetings to Solid Faith Church, and I'm wondering if you wanted to just share a word just from where you are, Pastor Kagochi. Jane, my friend, please.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. There is so much I want to thank you guys for, especially Pastor John, who has been there a long many years in this church. He welcomed me and then welcomed Trevor, then me, and now we have the whole family is here. That is Tony, Tony and the family. So I want to really appreciate and let you know that you are really part of us. Every Sunday we pray for you. And we thank God for each one of you and you, Pastor John. You have been a strong pillar, not only in this church and also in Kenya. And the comfort that I know that you are standing with my family really drives me very far. I could not have asked for a better pastor to pastor my family here. I thank you all for the love you have, and that is the love of Christ, which is unconditional. And I really thank God because before I came here, I hope I have a few minutes, before I came here, God had given me three summons of love. You love God, as the Bible says, with all your heart, you know that. You love thy neighbor as thyself. The third one is love thy enemy. How do you love your enemy? You can forgive your enemy, but it's hard to love your enemy. And I went through that, Pastor John, with a lady from the U.S. who lives in Kenya. And she's a good friend of mine. And every time we would meet, she would tell me that she's really wounded with what happened in the past between slavery, you know all about that. And she is like the fourth generation. And every time I would meet her, she would say, I cannot accept, I cannot love. And every time I would explain to her, then later on she told me, I have gone to three priests, Catholic priests, and through other preachers, but I have not changed. So right there, the Spirit of God gave me a word. And the word which God gave me was first to listen. Because you have to listen to hear where the person is coming from. And then you ask the Holy Spirit to give you the guidance and the right words so that the words do not have to come from me. Anything which comes from me without the Holy Spirit is zero work. But unless the word goes through the Holy Spirit, then there is power. And the power is to change each one of us. So I told her about Jesus. She already knows about that. And I told her, let's go back to the story of Jesus. That Jesus was born in Bethlehem. A creator created himself and became a baby and entered into a womb of a human being. And then from there, I told her, I remember what Jesus went through. He was persecuted for no reason at all, judged for things he never did because of you and I. Then I told her, look at it this way. Jesus did miracles. I want to make it short. When he was here, he showed unconditional love. And that unconditional love was, he fed people who were hungry. He healed the sick. He delivered the ones who needed deliverance from evil spirits and other stuff. But in all this, he showed love. But there came a time when he had to go to the hill of Calvary, carrying that cross, and he was beaten. And he was there on the cross. And people whom he healed their families, he fed bread, he delivered demons from them, were the same people who were saying, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. Jesus continued to love. And then he turned around and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. May God bless you. And from that time, that lady is totally healed. And I thank God for that. May God bless you. May God bless you. May God bless you. I love you all. And greetings from the Church of Solid Faith. We are with you all the way on the other side of the world. Thank you, Pastor John.
Amen. Amen. Partners in the gospel. Yes. Thank you. Return our greeting. We can keep going back and forth because Tony already brought greetings, but just say it's good. It's good that you are here. Blessings. Another special person who is here today, I'm looking at him right now, is Tyler Jensen. Tyler served here as a city as parish intern. I don't even remember the year, Tyler. 2009 to 2010. Here with his wife, Abigail, correct? Did I get that right? You want to just say a brief little hi? It is good to see you.
I'll try and be as brief as possible. Yes, I am now the pastor of Bethlehem Lutheran Church in Santa Rosa, California. Been there. Thank you. Yeah. And you know, this community has just been a huge blessing to me. The love, the faith, and the message that you have instilled in me, I continue to try and spread every day. It's just been such a wonderful experience to have been here, served here, learned from here, and hopefully try and bring the amazing work that this church does and the amazing heart that this church has to other people. You continue to inspire me every single day in my ministry. Thank you so much.
Amen. It's a day for visiting pastors. Just how it worked out. Okay, any other announcements that should be made as we then move into time of prayer? Okay. Yes, please, Brad.
And I'll do it. I know that they have to hear me, but I need some help next Sunday. Somebody needs to run the camera, and if you're available to do that, please come and see me afterwards. And if you have nothing else to do, because you're going to wake up at 10 o'clock and think, oh, I don't have to be in church yet, come and help set up. We have some set up to do as well.
Okay, and if anybody's hearing that online, he needs some help with somebody to help run the camera for outdoor worship next Sunday. Okay. All right. Any other announcements to be made? Yes, please. Trina, coming to you.
Well, we got to get it. The other Kagochis are back from the Philippines. Yay! You guys snuck in. So good to see you.
We haven't seen him yet.
Awesome. Welcome back. Okay, Kit now is going to gather the prayers of thanksgiving and concerns of our community. Oh, perfect. You're anticipating. Good. Your Thanksgiving.
Praise and thanksgiving do we have to pray today? Yes, Naoma?
Oh, you're right there.
We have a barbecue cookout for the church, but next Sunday's my birthday.
Okay. Ooh.
It's all to celebrate you. That's what it's about. Yep.
Kind of a mixed bag for my brother still, prayers, but they thought they were going to have to remove his bladder, and now they're going to immune therapy. It's kind of going back and forth. So prayers for all that, thanksgivings and prayers.
All right, how about prayer?
My other obvious celebration is that I have a husband again after a month, which is really, really nice. and he brought back my other mother, my second mom. So I'm so happy to have them.
Awesome. Wonderful. Okay. Here we go. Charles.
I have a celebration. My family is back. after long travels and praying for them to be safe. I see Trevor is back there from the Philippines and these two from Kenya. So really happy that God brought them back safely. Amen. Good.
I know that Pastor John lifted up prayer for the community. I also just want to lift up prayer for all of the staff that was impacted by these changes. And there's a lot of pain, a lot of anger, but just praying that God will provide for them. They will be comforted, and that they can have peace.
Yes. Moving into concerns. Yep.
I'd like to ask prayers for my friend Joe, who will be starting a four-month prison jail service this next week. So please pray for him.
Ask you all to continue to keep me in prayer. Should be getting notice from the procedure I had done two Fridays ago, hopefully this week. They said 7 to 10 business days, so this week would be the week that I get information. And as I shared last week, trusting Jesus through it all, whether it's a positive report or a report that there's more needs to be done, I just really appreciate the prayers.
Lifting up a prayer for Reverend Lyle Miller. Pastor Miller served peace as an interim pastor back years ago. His wife, Sonia, died recently. Prayers for his family, him and his family, for comfort and hope in God. Any others?
We are maybe still all having Demish and her family on our minds, but just want to remind us, anyone who maybe has been distracted, just to keep praying for Demish and her family.
Demish's son died, and prayers for comfort and hope for her.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, so much on our hearts today. Our hearts are heavy with news of the community center. We thank you for the years of service that been and the years to come that we'll be serving the community. But right now we are grieving. And I thank you for all that have helped and continue to help. And we ask that you guide us with this and in all things in our lives. We know personal concerns, grieving of loss of loved ones, health concerns, and celebrations that we have with you. In all those, we thank you for the promises of today's scripture that you are always with us and you love us and care for us and will get us through everything. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus loves me.
Gospel choir, come on up. And we remember in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Will you join me in praying the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is our Lord's meal, and everybody is invited to share in this meal of God's grace, God's forgiveness, God's love. We need that so much today. And then to be nourished by the meal and sent out to share that grace, forgiveness, love with the world. Please know that the dark cup here is the wine, the light cup is the grape juice. We have a gluten-free option for bread here. If you desire that, let me know. We will have prayer ministers in the prayer corner ready to pray one-on-one for folks who would like prayer for healing, health, hope, encouragement in your life. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. And if you're worshiping online today, time to receive bread, wine, grape juice, where you are, with the words, the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Oh. Please stand as you're able to receive words of blessing before we go. The body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. In Jesus, everything's going to be all right. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Amen.
Got a feeling,
be all right.
I've got a feeling. I've got a feeling. I got a feeling. It's gonna be all right, right, right. It's gonna be all right, right, right. Oh yeah. God's gonna make it right. God's gonna make it right. God's gonna make it right, right, right. Right, right, right. I've got a feeling. I've got a feeling. I've got a feeling. It's gonna be feeling. Oh yeah, oh yeah.
I've got a feeling. Everything is gonna be alright.
I've got a feeling.
Everything's gonna be alright. Be all right.